Going to look at a few passages in Romans and just a short devotion tonight. We'll start in Romans chapter 1. As you're turning there, a story about a missionary who was working in one of those countries with restricted access, meaning, you know, it's really difficult to get missionaries there. A lot of times you have to send in people to be something else, in theory. Teaching or engineering or farming or something, but they're also able to conduct some missionary work while they're there. Because for many years, the government of that particular country had taught the people there is no God. Yet the missionary had an opportunity to interact regularly with people, and he was talking several times with a non-believer of that country, a very highly educated professional. And after developing a friendship with this man, he had the opportunity to share the gospel story with him. And he was taken aback by the man's response. "What you have told me cannot be true, because if it were true, it is such good news that someone would have told me this before." Well, I'm glad you heard it at all. Would be my first response. But, you know, it's good news. And so maybe the song we sang tonight was a good introduction as well, you know. People need to hear the good news. In Romans chapter 1, verse 16, 17, Paul declared, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, righteousness that is by faith from first to the last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." Just will live by faith. And you can find that in some other passages in both the Old and New Testament. Paul here is quoting that from the Old Testament. The righteous will live by faith. You know, a lot of people who struggle with the simplicity of the gospel. And in a lot of ways, the gospel is very easy. It's very easy to understand. Sometimes it's hard to submit ourselves to, or at least for non-believers. You know, people have questions or they have doubts or concerns or whatever. But it's really a very simple message. But still, it seems like we as human beings have the ability to make something so complicated out of something so simple. And a classic example from history is a person by the name of Martin Luther, that monk from the 1500s. Now, I was going to a Christian school, you know, they thought Martin Luther just hung out the moon. I mean, he was just like this greatest person of history. So grew up hearing a lot about him, studying about him through the years. But it's fascinating to really dig into his pre-Christian life. Now, I'll share a little bit with you about this man, Martin Luther. He was as a young man, he was a law student, which may describe some of the ways that he thought and approached things. But he decided he wasn't going to go into the law, finally, for his life's work. He went to a monastery in a city in Germany called Erfurt. And he struggled with a religious question. This is one that literally kept him up at night. And the question is God my helper or my destroyer? And this is, again, from some of his own writings and others that have written about him from his day and time. In other words, how can I know that God is for me and not against me? And what can I do to satisfy, to please God? And he came to the monastery looking for an answer to find that question. And he worked as a monk in the 1500s monastery. He was described as a scrupulous monk. He said this about himself: "I kept the rule of my order so strictly that if ever a monk got to heaven by his monastic life, it was I. If I should have kept on it any longer, I would have killed myself with prayers and vigils and readings and other works." I mean, you want to talk about a guy who was locked into a works-type salvation. He's the poster child for works-type salvation, okay? So he's struggling with this. How perfect do you need to be in order to get into heaven? Well, totally perfect, absolutely perfect. Jesus said, "Your righteousness must surpass that of the scribes and the Pharisees." He was trying. So how does a person appease God? Well, here's some things that Luther would do. He would fast until he was about ready to pass out. He wore rough clothes. He got up at 1 a.m. to pray. He slept without blankets. But how much going without would be enough? How much, denying himself would be enough? How cold, how hungry, how sleepy, and uncomfortable do you have to be in order to impress a holy and righteous God? The problems with a works-type salvation is it never works. You can't ever do enough. And so he had this distressing anxiety, an anxiety of the soul, it's sometimes been called. It just wouldn't quit. Now, we might call that conviction. He was so close and yet so far. Remember, Jesus one time asked a man a question. The man gave a pretty good answer. He says, "You're not far from the kingdom of heaven." Mm-hmm. And that might be the case for the young Martin Luther. Distressing anxiety, conviction, whatever it was. So, well, in that day and time, they had a remedy for that. It's called confession. And the way they did this in these monasteries was that the monks were all assigned a more senior person in the monastery who was called your confessor. And that gentleman's name was Herr Staupitz. So Luther would go to confession for 2, 3, and even 6 hours a day. Guess he didn't have much else to do. Maybe that got him out of kitchen work. I don't know. But he was described, he would confess every little sin, wrong thought, anything that might be a sin. He would begin with the 7 deadly sins, go through all those, and just kind of run through every day, make sure you know all that. Then he would go through the 10 commandments, just to remind himself. And then if after leaving confession, he thought of some little thing, he'd rush back to the confessional and he'd start all over again. I mean, this guy went way over and beyond. A little bit like the Apostle Paul, who, described his zealous life before Christ also. Well, this guy who was his confessor said this always cracked me up. He said, he became exasperated and he said this. He said, "Listen here, Brother Martin. If you're going to come in here and confess so much, why don't you go out and actually do something worth confessing? Kill somebody. At least commit adultery or something in here. Not such flummery and fake sins." But the problem was the confession only made it worse for him, because he was focused always on what he could not achieve in his own works. He struggled, "Is God my Savior or my destroyer?" To be perfect, every sin would need to be confessed, thought Luther. "But if I forget one little sin and leave it unconfessed, therefore unforgiven, he would be unrighteous and unable to dwell with God." Oh, that made him miserable. Could he trust his memory? What if he forgot a sin to confess? Salvation, he and his fellow monks thought, was by rigorous, lengthy process with an uncertain outcome. So he decided what every good monk ought to do. He went to Rome to settle the argument. He viewed the relics in the Vatican. He bought indulgences and returned to Germany unsatisfied. Well, God is good. He put Luther where he needed to be. He was assigned to be a teacher at the University of Wittenberg, Germany. And he went there as a professor and he began to teach out of the book of Romans. And it wasn't very long before he came, going through verse by verse the book is how they taught. He came to verse 16 in chapter 1, the Gospels, the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. First for the Jew, then for the Gentiles. For in the Gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed. A righteousness that is by faith from first to last. Just as it is written. Here's where the light bulb came on for him. The just will live by faith. Phew, changed his world. It wasn't the only passages that he encountered, but that was really the start of it. He also, in his own writings, described how he came to Romans chapter 3 in verse 21. That picks up on what verse 17 in chapter 1 had said about a righteousness from God. Romans 3:21, "But now a righteousness from God apart from the law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify." The righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe.
There is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus.
What a lot of people is, they don't know what the word grace means.
Well, and they struggle with that. Is grace a free ticket? Is it something we earn? Is it, you know?
Talking to somebody that sees, what happens when you do a gross sin in your mind and then you get killed instantly?
Mm-hmm.
I said, nothing. Mm-hmm. I said, you're saved by grace through faith. Your works have nothing to do with keeping you saved or getting you saved.
Right.
You don't deserve to be saved. The very best you can be is not good enough. God had to look on you in grace and bestow upon you his righteousness because you weren't fit for nothing else.
Right. A righteousness from God.
Then you're saved. Now good works mean something.
Yes. And you bring up a good point.
You just looked
people,
at me dumbfounded.
And I know that the types of backgrounds that preach this, not only, because a lot of Christians today will say, well, you're saved by grace, but then you have to work to keep it. And that's just not a form of work salvation. That isn't it. Yeah. It's a righteousness from God. It is righteousness that we find in Christ, his righteousness imputed to us, that we are justified freely by grace.
Amen.
And that's what verse 24 is. You know, we often use verse 23 when we're witnessing to somebody, all sin falls short of the glory of God. But that's not the end of the sentence. Verse 24 concludes that thought. And are justified freely by his grace. Through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. It's what Jesus did that saves us through the grace of God in that we received that. Luther also, again, he being that lawyer background, that teacher background, that studier, he just poured into this kinds of stuff. And it's good because, you know, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing by the word of God. And he was reading it. In chapter 4, it says, what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, when a man works, I'm in verse 4 now, his wages are not credited to him as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the man who does not work, I'm not meaning have an employment, but have work as in what Luther was trying to do, to do all these good works, who does not work, but trusts God who justifies the wicked, his faith is credited as righteousness. Oh, the light bulbs are just coming on. And then, of course, we know in chapter 10, it says that it's within our heart that we believe and are justified. We confess with our mouths and are saved. He said this, day and night I pondered the justice of God and this statement, the just shall live by faith. Righteousness of God, a righteousness given to sinners by grace. And he no longer needed the burden of self-justification. By grace, God had taken care of everything. And he concluded in his own, I guess you'd call it an autobiography. I felt the gates of paradise had opened and I had entered in, having been reborn. And of course, this whole concept, Luther coming to know God by faith alone, or through faith, through grace, and because of Jesus, as Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 say, you know, we're saved by grace, through faith. It's our faith in Jesus. It's a work that Jesus did. Had a little something to do with having effect on some other people, too. He was so convicted by the false teaching around him that he did what was common in that day, which was to write up statements of belief using scripture to back up those points and then to post them publicly. And the way you did that was as you tacked them on the church door where people could come and read them. And he put his 95 theses on the church door, and well, that kind of stirred things up, but you know, the rest, as they say, is history. But he found that. I just always found it fascinating. I mean, here's a guy who took works type salvation to the absolute extreme. I can't imagine working any harder. You know, Paul, though, you know, talks about some of the all same lines, you know, the things that he did and the qualities that he had about himself, you know, being of the right tribe of Benjamin. And he was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. And according to the law, he was blameless and all these other things. And then he comes down and says, you know, but everything that I used to have, I consider rubbish compared to knowing the goodness and salvation and grace of God